nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Welcome back. I'm Professor Rickus. In this lecture, we're going to talk about negative autoregulation of gene expression. We'll look at the steady state protein level, the gene product level, and the impact of, if you recall, the N parameter in our Hill function model of expression, and talk about the impact of that in a negative autoregulation model and how that leads to robustness, and look at the sensitivity to parameter noise. So, what is negative autoregulation? So let's start with reminding ourselves of simple repression. So in simple repression, we have a repressor such as protein X that blocks or inhibits and reduces the probability of expression of protein Y. So our network view would look like this. Negative autoregulation is when a gene product of X comes back and negatively inhibits its own expression. So our network view would look like this, with this circle sort of coming back around and inhibiting. And you may ask yourself, well, that's sort of a strange motif. Why, if I want to make a bunch of X, why would that come around and inhibit itself? Why would it have that negative feedback? And that's what we're going to take a look at today, that why. So let's start with our familiar Hill function model. And so now we've got of repression. But now, because we're negative autoregulation, previously where we had looking at, we were looking at the effect of dy dt, right? And our term in here on our repression was different. One was x and one was y. Now our dx dt is solely a function of x. And in our repressor term, x is now repressing its own expression here in our generation. And again, we have our familiar decay term minus alpha x. So steady state occurs when dx dt equals zero, or looking at it a little bit differently, the rate of decay equals the rate of production or expression. And it's very useful to examine this graphically. So if we plot alpha x, along over on our graph here, along with beta over 1 plus x over k. And remember, k is our threshold for the effect of that repressor x on expression. Looked another way, it's the concentration at which the effect of x is half represses the maximum expression, as a reminder. And so here we've plot for in the case of n equal 1. So I've just inserted n equal 1 into our function here and plot now. And so there's a few things that come up by looking at this graphical view of our steady state. The first thing that becomes obvious is that we have only one possible steady state. We'll call this x sub ss for any parameter set. It's also very easy to visualize how the parameters will impact our steady state level. So for example here, if alpha gets bigger, then simply the slope of alpha x goes up, and as we have in our green, and we can then easily follow now where our decay and our production cross, we can see how our steady state would move, right? So we can see it gets smaller. And so if alpha got bigger, x steady state gets smaller. We can easily see too, if the slope gets smaller, if alpha 2 goes down, then that should be alpha 2 less than alpha. Then the slope goes down, and we can see our steady state shown in red here, xss2 would get bigger. So this graphical view is often very convenient to very quickly get sort of a sense of what are the possible behaviors of your steady state for different parameter values. Okay, so let's examine the extreme case of very large n. So as n approaches infinity, our production becomes like almost like a switch now, becomes more switch-like the more n gets larger. And expression is basically on or off, right? It's either at a level of beta, maximal expression, or it's at the level of zero and is off. Okay, so what happens here now when we look at how our production curve crosses our decay curve, we see that our X steady state becomes locked into one value. And it becomes locked in at our level of our K value, our threshold of repression. So no matter how I move alpha in this case, alpha gets bigger again, I see my green line, my steady state doesn't change. If alpha gets smaller, I see my red line, again, they cross at the same level of X. We lock in our steady state to our threshold parameter. Another way to look at this or to think about it is that our steady state has become insensitive to our parameter. So increasing N in our negative autoregulation loop decreases sensitivity to parameters. The steady state expression level is then more robust to any noise in those parameters. Okay, so let's compare again, going back to our simple negative regulation and compare this to our negative autoregulation. So here we have simple negative autoregulation. And remember, in our production, if Y in this case was repressing X, right, we would have Y in our expression term. And so, but our expression term is then independent of X. Okay, so if we were to plot f of X as a function of X, we would have this straight line depending on, and that level could be changed by beta, and it could be changed of whatever level our Y is at. But in our negative autoregulation, this expression term, as we saw previously, depends on X. And here now I've written it a little bit more generically, putting some curvature into our production term, leaving that N term in there. So note that in simple regulation, X is proportional to beta and to alpha. So if we were to increase beta by 50%, our steady state value of our gene expression of gene product X would simply increase by 50% as well. So therefore, if beta is noisy, right, if our transcription and translational events are noisy, this noise will propagate linearly into the steady state level of our protein gene product X. So we can define this a little bit more quantitatively, and we can do this using a sensitivity coefficient. So if we simply define this sensitivity coefficient as X, as how it's sensitive to parameter beta. And so we can just define this as this ratio of the change in steady state level over that nominal level, right, as a ratio to the percentage or the relative ratio of how much the parameter were to change. So if we change our parameter by a certain amount relative to that parameter value, how much does the steady state value change relative to that nominal value, right? So for simple repression, as we just saw, that sensitivity coefficient is just simply 1, right? We change our beta value by 50%, and our steady state value of our gene product changes by that same amount of 50%. So if we now look at this in a differential form and think of infinitely small changes, we can rearrange and rewrite this now as our sensitivity coefficient as beta over our steady state gene product level times our steady state, taking the derivative of our steady state gene product level with respect to beta. And so we looked at this for simple repression, and it's easy to see that our sensitivity coefficient is 1. And the question is, what about our negative autoregulation? So we can do this by starting with our equation for our sensitivity coefficient. And we can then go in and solve from our rate equation for our negative autoregulation for our steady state value of X, right? So we can solve for what this value of X is, where our production is equal to our decay, and solve that for XSS as a function of the parameters, including our threshold, our beta, our alpha, and our N value coefficient. So now we can ask, we can define our sensitivity coefficient and find a function of that for each of the parameters. And here we'll do that for beta. So we simply then plug in our x steady state function, as well as taking the derivative of that function with respect to beta and plugging into our sensitivity coefficient equation. And when we do that, that actually collapses down then, and our sensitivity coefficient is equal to 1 over n plus 1, right? So let's look at this a little bit more deeply now. So if we were to plug in different values of n, our Hill function coefficient in our production, for n equals 0, we would just basically collapse down and have a sensitivity of 1. Again, this is like our simple repression case, where 50% increase in beta, we get a 50% increase in steady state. Now, as we increase n from 1 to 2 to 4, and up to our extreme case of infinity that we looked at, we can see now that our sensitivity coefficient begins to decrease and eventually approach 0, where we're insensitive. So an n of 1 decreases our sensitivity coefficient to 1/2. An n of 2 decreases our sensitivity coefficient to 1/3, and so on. And so what this means now is that a 50% change in beta when our n is 1 would only result in a 25% change in our steady state value of our gene product. An n of 2 in the same case would result in only 16% change in our steady state value. And an n up to 4, we would only see a 10% change in our steady state value, given a 50% difference in our beta maximal rate of expression. And all the way down to being independent of beta, as we previously saw when we looked at the extreme of n equals infinity. So the message from this is that the n coefficient on the autorepression Hill function increases the robustness of the system. So you can sort of think of robustness in this case as an opposite of sensitivity. It is less sensitive to fluctuations in the parameters. Again, it's useful to look a little more closely at our extremes. So in the case for n equals 0, as we mentioned previously, that our equations just collapse to our familiar simple steady state for simple repression, right? So if n is 0, then our steady state is just beta over alpha, which we previously looked at in past lectures for simple repression using the Hill function model, right? And our sensitivity coefficient is 1. In the extreme, when n equals infinity or approaches infinity, our steady state value of our gene product level becomes independent of beta and becomes locked in to k, and our sensitivity coefficient is 0. So reality is actually somewhere in between, right? So let's think about that. So many repressors actually bind as dimers, and n reflects but is not strictly equal to the stoichiometry of binding of our repressors. So as I said, many repressors will bind as dimers. So in this case, our gene product here, X, will come back, form a dimer with another molecule of X, and bind upstream of its own gene to regulate and repress its own expression as a dimer. And so this is one way to increase that N value in our Hill function coefficient to create that nonlinearity in that function. And N is between 1 and 5 is reasonable. 4 and 5 is less common, but certainly observed. So that gives you some sense of sort of where reality is in relation to our extremes that we looked at. And so we should ask ourselves, as we always should, does this model of robustness hold up in reality? And so We're going to take a look at a piece of work that was published in Nature in 2000 that did exactly this and asked exactly this question. So what they did was, here they're comparing, we have sort of just a different circuit view now, gene view of our a negative autoregulation, right? So where a transcription factor then comes back and negatively and represses its own expression, and comparing that to just simple expression of that gene. And if they looked at the simulated predictions of the distribution, so now they're looking at a population of cells. And what you're looking at here is a histogram, a cell count versus concentration here. And so, and you can think of this, so if there's variability in parameters, you would see that variability in cell-to-cell variability. And the question is, how does that cell-to-cell variability or differences in that parameter value affect the average and distribution of the gene product expression level in that population of cells? Okay, and so they're looking at this through these histograms. These are simulations from model predictions, and the simulated predictions predicted the distribution of expression in these populations of cells, and they predict that a negative autoregulated system would have much less variability in the population of expression due to the natural variation and noise in the parameter values, such as the beta and expression levels and the variance in those transcription and translation rates. And so you see a pretty extreme difference here in our populations comparing the negative autoregulation and in just simple expression. So again, this is their model prediction of their system, and they constructed then the physical system to represent these cases. So they use the TET repressor system, and so in these real cells, they are now expressing this repressor that is a fusion to a fluorescent protein, EGFP in this case, so that they could monitor and measure expression of the gene. And so they looked at this in three cases. Here we have our TET repressor, right? So the gene product comes back and inhibits its own expression, right? So we've got sort of the native negative feedback autoregulation repressor system. Then they created two control or comparisons groups. They created a mutation in the repressor. So they had a mutation that prevented the repression activity of the inability of the gene to come back and repress its own expression. They also replaced upstream of the expression, replaced the TET operator with a lac operator. So the TET repressor then should not be able to come back. It should have no effect on the upstream operator then, because it's been replaced with, from the TET has been swapped out for the lac. And here you have their actual data from their cells. So they're looking at the fluorescent output or the protein level. And again, comparing the negative autoregulation with their two control comparisons of no autoregulation. And you can see that, in fact, their negative autoregulation case has a much tighter distribution. It is much less noisy in the steady state value expression level of the gene compared to the case of simple expression where there's repressions either been blocked or doesn't exist. So in this case, they were able to show that their experimental and their engineered circuits were behaving as they would expect from the model prediction, and sort of further giving evidence that negative autoregulation is one way to, one of its functional outcomes is to improve the robustness of the system and decrease variability in gene expression levels. Okay, so coming up, we're gonna keep diving into some more gene circuit motifs. Next up is feed forward loops, and we'll continue to look at how these motifs have design features, such as we just saw for negative autoregulation and robustness. we'll see how feed-forward loops can engineer some other design features into both our natural and engineered systems.